Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents The Panda's Thumb, More Reflections in Natural History by Stephen Jay Gould. Narrated by Jonathan Sleep. Prologue. On the title page of his classic book, The Cell in Development and Inheritance, E.B. Wilson inscribed a motto from Pliny, the great natural historian who died in his boots when he sailed across the Bay of Naples to study the eruption of Mount Vesuvius in A.D. 79. He suffocated in the same vapors that choked the citizens of Pompeii. Pliny wrote, "Natura nusquam magis est tota quam in minimis." Nature is to be found in her entirety, nowhere more than in her smallest creatures. Wilson, of course, commandeered Pliny's statement to celebrate the microscopic building blocks of life, minute structures unknown perforce to the great Roman. Pliny was thinking about organisms. Pliny's statement captures the essence of what fascinates me about natural history. In an old stereotype, not followed nearly so often as mythology proclaims, the natural history essay restricts itself to describing the peculiarities of animals, the mysterious ways of the beaver, or how the spider weaves her supple web. There is exaltation in this, and who shall gainsay it? But each organism can mean so much more to us. Each instructs. Its form and behavior embodies general messages if only we can learn to read them. The language of this instruction is evolutionary theory, exaltation, and explanation. I was lucky to wander into evolutionary theory, one of the most exciting and important of all scientific fields. I had never heard of it when I started at a rather tender age. I was simply awed by dinosaurs. I thought paleontologists spent their lives digging up bones and putting them together, never venturing beyond the momentous issue of what connects to what. Then I discovered evolutionary theory. Ever since then, the duality of natural history, richness in particularities, and potential union in underlying explanation has propelled me. I think the fascination so many people feel for evolutionary theory resides in three of its properties. First, it is, in its current state of development, sufficiently firm to provide satisfaction and confidence, yet fruitfully undeveloped enough to provide a treasure trove of mysteries. Second, it stands in the middle of a continuum stretching from sciences that deal in timeless, quantitative generality to those that work directly with the singularities of history. Thus, it provides a home for all styles and propensities, from those who seek the purity of abstraction, the laws of population growth and the structure of DNA, to those who revel in the messiness of irreducible peculiarity. What, if anything, did Tyrannosaurus do with its puny front legs anyway? Third, it touches all our lives, for how can we be indifferent to the great questions of genealogy? Where do we come from, and what does it all mean? And then, of course, there are all those organisms, more than a million described species, from bacterium to blue whale, with one hell of a lot of beetles in between, each with its own beauty, and each with a story to tell. These essays range broadly in the phenomena they treat, from the origin of life to the brain of Georges Cuvier to a mite that dies before it is born. Yet I hope that I've avoided that incubus of essay collections, diffuse incoherence, by centering them all upon evolutionary theory with an emphasis on Darwin's thoughts and impact. As I stated in introducing my previous collection, Ever Since Darwin, I am a tradesman, not a polymath. What I know of planets and politics lies at their intersection with biological evolution. I've tried to weld these essays into an integrated whole by organizing them into eight sections. The first, on pandas, turtles, and anglerfish, illustrates why we can be confident that evolution occurred. The argument embodies a paradox. The proof of evolution lies in imperfections that reveal history. This section is followed by a club sandwich, three sections on major themes in the evolutionary study of natural history, Darwinian theory and the meaning of adaptation, the tempo and mode of change and the scaling of size and time, and two intervening layers of two sections each, 3 and 4 and 6 and 7, on organisms and the peculiarities of their history. If anyone wants to pursue the metaphorical sandwich and divide these 7 sections into supporting structure and meat, I will not be offended. I have also impaled the sandwich with toothpicks, subsidiary themes common to all sections, and intended to prick some conventional comforts. Why science must be embedded in culture, why Darwinism cannot be squared with hopes for intrinsic harmony or progress in nature. But each pinprick has its positive consequence. An understanding of cultural bias forces us to view science as an accessible human activity, much like any form of creativity. An abandonment of the hope that we might read a meaning for our lives passively in nature compels us to seek answers within ourselves. These essays are lightly edited versions of my monthly columns in Natural History magazine, collectively titled This View of Life. I've added postscripts to a few, additional evidence of Teilhard's possible involvement in the Piltdown fraud, Essay 10, a letter from J. Harlan Bretz, controversial as ever at 96, 19, confirmation from the Southern Hemisphere for an explanation of magnets in bacteria, 30. I thank Ed Barber for persuading me that these essays might be less ephemeral than I thought. Natural History's editor-in-chief, Alan Tiernes, and copy editor Florence Edelstein have greatly helped in deconvolution of phrase and thought and in devising some good titles. 4 essays would not have been without the gracious help of colleagues. Carolyn Fleur Loban introduced me to Dr. Down, sent me his obscure article, and shared her insights and writing with me, Essay 15. Ernst Mayr has urged the importance of folk taxonomy for years and had all the references on hand, Essay 20. Jim Kennedy introduced me to Kirkpatrick's work, Essay 22. Otherwise, I would never have penetrated the veil of silence surrounding it. Richard Frankel wrote me an unsolicited 4-page letter explaining lucidly to this physical dunce the magnetic properties of his fascinating bacteria, Essay 30. I am always cheered and delighted by the generosity of colleagues. 1,000 untold stories overbalance every eagerly recorded case of nastiness. I thank Frank Sulloway for telling me the true story of Darwin's finches, Essay 5. Diane Paul, Martha Denkla, Tim White, Andy Knoll, and Carl Wunsch for references, insights, and patient explanation. Fortunately, I write these essays during an exciting time in evolutionary theory. When I think of paleontology in 1910, with its wealth of data and void of ideas, I regard it as a privilege to be working today. Evolutionary theory is expanding its domain of impact and explanation in all directions. Consider the current excitement in such disparate realms as the basic mechanics of DNA, embryology, and the study of behavior. Molecular evolution is now a full-fledged discipline that promises to provide both strikingly new ideas, the theory of neutrality as an alternative to natural selection, and resolution of many classical mysteries in natural history. At the same time, the discovery of inserted sequences and jumping genes reveals a new stratum of genetic complexity that must be pregnant with evolutionary meaning. The triplet code is only a machine language. A higher level of control must exist. If we can ever figure out how multicellular creatures regulate the timing involved in the complex orchestration of their embryonic growth, then developmental biology might unite molecular genetics with natural history into a unified science of life. The theory of kin selection has extended Darwinian theory fruitfully into the realm of social behavior, though I believe that its more zealous advocates misunderstand the hierarchical nature of explanation and try to extend it, by more than permissible analogy, to realms of human culture where it does not apply. Yet while Darwinian theory extends its domain, some of its cherished postulates are slipping, or at least losing their generality. The modern synthesis, the contemporary version of Darwinism that has reigned for 30 years, took the model of adaptive gene substitution within local populations as an adequate account by accumulation and extension of life's entire history. The model may work well in its empirical domain of minor local adaptive adjustment. Populations of the moth Biston betularia did turn black by substitution of a single gene as a selected response for decreased visibility on trees that had been blackened by industrial soot. But is the origin of a new species simply this process extended to more genes and greater effect? Are larger evolutionary trends within major lineages just a further accumulation of sequential adaptive changes? Many evolutionists, myself included, are beginning to challenge this synthesis and to assert the hierarchical view that different levels of evolutionary change often reflect different kinds of causes. Minor adjustment within populations may be sequential and adaptive, but speciation may occur by major chromosomal changes that establish sterility with other species for reasons unrelated to adaptation. Evolutionary trends may represent a kind of higher-level selection upon essentially static species themselves, not the slow and steady alteration of a single large population through untold ages. Before the modern synthesis, many biologists expressed confusion and depression because the proposed mechanisms of evolution at different levels seemed contradictory enough to preclude a unified science. After the modern synthesis, the notion spread, amounting almost to a dogma among its less thoughtful lieutenants, that all evolution could be reduced to the basic Darwinianism of gradual adaptive change within local populations. I think that we are now pursuing a fruitful path between the anarchy of Bateson's day and the restriction of view imposed by the modern synthesis. The modern synthesis works in its appropriate arena, but the same Darwinian processes of mutation and selection may operate in strikingly different ways at higher domains in a hierarchy of evolutionary levels. I think that we may hope for uniformity of causal agents, hence a single general theory with a Darwinian core. But we must reckon with a multiplicity of mechanisms that preclude the explanation of higher-level phenomena by the model of adaptive gene substitution favored for the lowest level. At the basis of all this ferment lies nature's irreducible complexity. Organisms are not billiard balls propelled by simple and measurable external forces to predictable new positions on life's pool table. Sufficiently complex systems have greater richness. Organisms have a history that constrains their future in myriad subtle ways. Their complexity of form entails a host of functions incidental to whatever pressures of natural selection superintended the initial construction. Their intricate and largely unknown pathways of embryonic development guarantee that simple inputs, minor changes in timing, for example, may be translated into marked and surprising changes in output. Charles Darwin chose to close his great book with a striking comparison that expresses this richness. He contrasted the simpler system of planetary motion and its result of endless static cycling with the complexity of life and its wondrous and unpredictable change through the ages. There is grandeur in this view of life, with its several powers having been originally breathed into a few forms or into one, and that whilst this planet has gone cycling on according to the fixed law of gravity, from so simple a beginning, endless forms, most beautiful and most wonderful, have been and are being evolved. 1. Perfection and Imperfection, a Trilogy on a Panda's Thumb. 1. The Panda's Thumb. Few heroes lower their sights in the prime of their lives. Triumph leads inexorably on, often to destruction. Alexander wept because he had no new worlds to conquer. Napoleon, overextended, sealed his doom in the depth of a Russian winter. But Charles Darwin did not follow The Origin of Species, 1859, with a general defense of natural selection or with its evident extension to human evolution. He waited until 1871 to publish The Descent of Man. Instead, he wrote his most obscure work, a book entitled On the Various Contrivances by Which British and Foreign Orchids Are Fertilized by Insects, 1862. Darwin's many excursions into the minutiae of natural history, he wrote a taxonomy of barnacles, a book on climbing plants, and a treatise on the formation of vegetable mold by earthworms, won him an undeserved reputation as an old-fashioned, somewhat doddering describer of curious plants and animals, a man who had one lucky insight at the right time. A rash of Darwinian scholarship has laid this myth firmly to rest during the past 20 years. Before then, one prominent scholar spoke for many ill-informed colleagues when he judged Darwin as a poor joiner of ideas, a man who does not belong with the great thinkers. In fact, each of Darwin's books played its part in the grand and coherent scheme of his life's work, demonstrating the fact of evolution and defending natural selection as its primary mechanism. Darwin did not study orchids solely for their own sake. Michael Giselin, a California biologist who finally took the trouble to read all of Darwin's books, see his triumph of the Darwinian method, has correctly identified the treatise on orchids as an important episode in Darwin's campaign for evolution. Darwin begins his orchid book with an important evolutionary premise. Continued self-fertilization is a poor strategy for long-term survival, since offspring carry only the genes of their single parent, and populations do not maintain enough variation for evolutionary flexibility in the face of environmental change. Thus, plants bearing flowers with both male and female parts usually evolve mechanisms to ensure cross-pollination. Orchids have formed an alliance with insects. They've evolved an astonishing variety of contrivances to attract insects, guarantee that sticky pollen adheres to their visitor, and ensure that the attached pollen comes in contact with female parts of the next orchid visited by the insect. Darwin's book is a compendium of these contrivances, the botanical equivalent of a bestiary, and like the medieval bestiaries, it is designed to instruct. The message is paradoxical but profound. Orchids manufacture their intricate devices from the common components of ordinary flowers, parts usually fitted for very different functions. If God had designed a beautiful machine to reflect his wisdom and power, surely he would not have used a collection of parts generally fashioned for other purposes. Orchids were not made by an ideal engineer. They are jury-rigged from a limited set of available components. Thus, they must have evolved from ordinary flowers. Thus, the paradox and the common theme of this trilogy of essays, our textbooks like to illustrate evolution with examples of optimal design, nearly perfect mimicry of a dead leaf by a butterfly, or of a poisonous species by a palatable relative. But ideal design is a lousy argument for evolution, for it mimics the postulated action of an omnipotent creator. Odd arrangements and funny solutions are the proof of evolution, paths that a sensible God would never tread, but that a natural process constrained by history follows perforce. No one understood this better than Darwin. Ernst Mayr has shown how Darwin, in defending evolution, consistently turned to organic parts and geographic distributions that make the least sense, which brings me to the giant panda and its thumb. Giant pandas are peculiar bears, members of the order Carnivora. Conventional bears are the most omnivorous representatives of their order, but pandas have restricted this catholicity of taste in the other direction. They belie the name of their order by subsisting almost entirely on bamboo. They live in dense forests of bamboo at high elevations in the mountains of western China. There they sit, largely unthreatened by predators, munching bamboo 10 to 12 hours each day. As a childhood fan of Andy Panda and former owner of a stuffed toy won by some fluke when all the milk bottles actually tumbled at the county fair, I was delighted when the first fruits of our thaw with China went beyond ping pong to the shipment of two pandas to the Washington Zoo. I went and watched in appropriate awe. They yawned, stretched, and ambled a bit, but they spent nearly all their time feeding on their beloved bamboo. They sat upright and manipulated the stalks with their forepaws, shedding the leaves and consuming only the shoots. I was amazed by their dexterity and wondered how the scion of a stalk adapted for running could use its hands so adroitly. They held the stalks of bamboo in their paws and stripped off the leaves by passing the stalks between an apparently flexible thumb and the remaining fingers. This puzzled me. I'd learned that a dexterous, opposable thumb stood among the hallmarks of human success. We had maintained, even exaggerated, this important flexibility of our primate forebears, while most mammals had sacrificed it in specializing their digits. Carnivores run, stab, and scratch. My cat may manipulate me psychologically, but he'll never type or play the piano. So I counted the panda's other digits and received an even greater surprise. There were 5, not 4. Was the thumb a separately evolved 6th finger? Fortunately, the giant panda has its Bible, a monograph by D. Dwight Davis, late curator of vertebrate anatomy at Chicago's Field Museum of Natural History. It is probably the greatest work of modern evolutionary comparative anatomy, and it contains more than anyone would ever want to know about pandas. Davis had the answer, of course. The panda's thumb is not anatomically a finger at all. It is constructed from a bone called the radial sesamoid, normally a small component of the wrist. In pandas, the radial sesamoid is greatly enlarged and elongated until it almost equals the metapodial bones of the true digits in length. The radial sesamoid underlies a pad on the panda's forepaw. The 5 digits form the framework of another pad, the palmar. A shallow furrow separates the 2 pads and serves as a channelway for bamboo stalks. The panda's thumb comes equipped not only with a bone to give it strength, but also with muscles to sustain its agility. These muscles, like the radial sesamoid bone itself, did not arise de novo. Like the parts of Darwin's orchids, they are familiar bits of anatomy remodeled for a new function. The abductor of the radial sesamoid, the muscle that pulls it away from the true digits, bears the formidable name abductor pollicis longus, the long abductor of the thumb. Pollicis is the genitive of pollex, Latin for thumb. Its name is a giveaway. In other carnivores, this muscle attaches to the first digit, or true thumb. 2 shorter muscles run between the radial sesamoid and the pollex. They pull the sesamoid thumb towards the true digits. Does the anatomy of other carnivores give us any clue to the origin of this odd arrangement in pandas? Davis points out that ordinary bears and raccoons, the closest relatives of giant pandas, far surpass all other carnivores in using their forelegs for manipulating objects and feeding. Pardon the backward metaphor, but pandas, thanks to their ancestry, began with a leg up for evolving greater dexterity in feeding. Moreover, ordinary bears already have a slightly enlarged radial sesamoid. In most carnivores, the same muscles that move the radial sesamoid in pandas attach exclusively to the base of the pollex, or true thumb. But in ordinary bears, the long abductor muscle ends in 2 tendons. One inserts into the base of the thumb, as in most carnivores, but the other attaches to the radial sesamoid. The 2 shorter muscles also attach, in part, to the radial sesamoid in bears. Thus, Davis concludes, the musculature for operating this remarkable new mechanism, functionally a new digit, required no intrinsic change from conditions already present in the panda's closest relatives, the bears. Furthermore, it appears that the whole sequence of events in the musculature follows automatically from simple hypertrophy of the sesamoid bone. The sesamoid thumb of pandas is a complex structure formed by marked enlargement of a bone and an extensive rearrangement of musculature. Yet Davis argues that the entire apparatus arose as a mechanical response to growth of the radial sesamoid itself. Muscles shifted because the enlarged bone blocked them short of their original sites. Moreover, Davis postulates that the enlarged radial sesamoid may have been fashioned by a simple genetic change, perhaps a single mutation affecting the timing and rate of growth. In a panda's foot, the counterpart of the radial sesamoid, called the tibial sesamoid, is also enlarged, although not so much as the radial sesamoid. Yet the tibial sesamoid supports no new digit, and its increased size confers no advantage so far as we know. Davis argues that the coordinated increase of both bones in response to natural selection upon one alone probably reflects a simple kind of genetic change. Repeated parts of the body are not fashioned by the action of individual genes. There is no gene for your thumb, another for your big toe, or a third for your pinky. Repeated parts are coordinated in development. Selection for a change in one element causes a corresponding modification in others. It may be genetically more complex to enlarge a thumb and not to modify a big toe than to increase both together. In the first case, a general coordination must be broken, the thumb favored separately, and correlated increase of related structures suppressed. In the second, a single gene may increase the rate of growth in a field regulating the development of corresponding digits. The panda's thumb provides an elegant zoological counterpart to Darwin's orchids. An engineer's best solution is debarred by history. The panda's true thumb is committed to another role, too specialized for a different function to become an opposable, manipulating digit. So the panda must use parts on hand and settle for an enlarged wrist bone and a somewhat clumsy but quite workable solution. The sesamoid thumb wins no prize in an engineer's derby. It is, to use Michael Gislin's phrase, a contraption, not a lovely contrivance. But it does its job and excites our imagination all the more because it builds on such improbable foundations. Darwin's orchid book is filled with similar illustrations. The marsh epipactus, for example, uses its labellum, an enlarged petal, as a trap. The labellum is divided into two parts. One near the flower's base forms a large cup filled with nectar, the object of an insect's visit. The other, near the flower's edge, forms a sort of landing stage. An insect alighting on this runway depresses it and thus gains entrance to the nectar cup beyond. It enters the cup, but the runway is so elastic that it instantly springs up, trapping the insect within the nectar cup. The insect must then back out through the only available exit, a path that forces it to brush against the pollen masses. A remarkable machine, but all developed from a conventional petal, a part readily available in an orchid's ancestor. Darwin then shows how the same labellum in other orchids evolves into a series of ingenious devices to ensure cross-fertilization. It may develop a complex fold that forces an insect to detour its proboscis around and past the pollen masses in order to reach nectar. It may contain deep channels or guiding ridges that lead insects both to nectar and pollen. The channels sometimes form a tunnel, producing a tubular flower. All these adaptations have been built from a part that began as a conventional petal in some ancestral form. Yet nature can do so much with so little that it displays, in Darwin's words, a prodigality of resources for gaining the very same end, namely the fertilization of one flower by pollen from another plant. Darwin's metaphor for organic form reflects his sense of wonder that evolution can fashion such a world of diversity and adequate design with such limited raw material. Although an organ may not have been originally formed for some special purpose, if it now serves for this end, we are justified in saying that it is specially contrived for it. On the same principle, if a man were to make a machine for some special purpose, but were to use old wheels, springs, and pulleys only slightly altered, the whole machine with all its parts might be said to be specially contrived for that purpose. Thus, throughout nature, almost every part of every living being has probably served, in a slightly modified condition, for diverse purposes, and has acted in the living machinery of many ancient and distinct specific forms. We may not be flattered by the metaphor of refurbished wheels and pulleys, but consider how well we work. Nature is, in biologist François Jacob's words, an excellent tinkerer, not a divine artificer. And who shall sit in judgment between these exemplary skills? 2. Senseless signs of history. Words provide clues about their history when etymology does not match current meaning. Thus, we suspect that emoluments were once fees paid to the local miller, from the Latin molere, to grind, while disasters must have been blamed upon evil stars. Evolutionists have always viewed linguistic changes as a fertile field for meaningful analogies. Charles Darwin, advocating an evolutionary interpretation for such vestigial structures as the human appendix and the embryonic teeth of whalebone whales, wrote, "Rudimentary organs may be compared with the letters in a word, still retained in the spelling, but becoming useless in the pronunciation, but which serve as a clue in seeking for its derivation. Both organisms and languages evolve." This essay masquerades behind a list of curious facts, but it is really an abstract discourse on method or rather on a particular method widely used but still appreciated by scientists. In the stereotyped image, scientists rely upon experiment and logic. A middle-aged man in a white coat, most stereotypes are sexist, either shyly reticent but burning with an inner zeal for truth, or else ebullient and eccentric, pours two chemicals together and watches his answer emerge in a flask. Hypotheses, predictions, experiments, and answers, the scientific method. But many sciences do not and cannot work this way. As a paleontologist and evolutionary biologist, my trade is in the reconstruction of history. History is unique and complex. It cannot be reproduced in a flask. Scientists who study history, particularly an ancient and unobservable history not recorded in human or geological chronicles, must use inferential rather than experimental methods. They must examine modern results of historical processes and try to reconstruct the path leading from ancestral to contemporary words, organisms, or landforms. Once the path is traced, we may be able to specify the causes that led history to follow this rather than another route. But how can we infer pathways from modern results? In particular, how can we be sure that there was a pathway at all? How do we know that a modern result is the product of alteration through history and not an immutable part of a changeless universe? This is the problem that Darwin faced, for his creationist opponents did view each species as unaltered from its initial formation. How did Darwin prove that modern species are the products of history? We might suppose that he looked toward the most impressive results of evolution, the complex and perfected adaptations of organisms to their environments, the butterfly passing for a dead leaf, the bittern for a branch, the superb engineering of a gull aloft or a tuna in the sea. Paradoxically, he did just the opposite. He searched for oddities and imperfections. The gull may be a marvel of design. If one believes in evolution beforehand, then the engineering of its wing reflects the shaping power of natural selection. But you cannot demonstrate evolution with perfection because perfection need not have a history. After all, perfection of organic design had long been the favorite argument of creationists, who saw in consummate engineering the direct hand of a divine architect. A bird's wing, as an aerodynamic marvel, might have been created exactly as we find it today. But, Darwin reasoned, if organisms have a history, then ancestral stages should leave remnants behind. Remnants of the past that don't make sense in present terms. The useless, the odd, the peculiar, the incongruous are the signs of history. They supply proof that the world was not made in its present form. When history perfects, it covers its own tracks. Why should a general word for monetary compensation refer literally to a profession now virtually extinct, unless it once had some relation with grinding and grain? And why should the fetus of a whale make teeth in its mother's womb only to resorb them later and live a life sifting krill on a whalebone filter, unless its ancestors had functional teeth and these teeth survive as a remnant during a stage when they do no harm? No evidence for evolution pleased Darwin more than the presence in nearly all organisms of rudimentary or vestigial structures, parts in this strange condition, bearing the stamp of unutility, as he put it. On my view of descent with modification, the origin of rudimentary organs is simple, he continued. They are bits of useless anatomy, preserved as remnants of functional parts in ancestors. The general point extends both beyond rudimentary structures and beyond biology to any historical science. Oddities in current terms are the signs of history. The first essay of this trilogy raised the same subject in a different context. The panda's thumb demonstrates evolution because it is clumsy and built from an odd part, the radial sesamoid bone of the wrist. The true thumb had been so shaped in its ancestral role as the running and clawing digit of a carnivore that it could not be modified into an opposable grasper for bamboo in a vegetarian descendant. In a non-biological musing, I found myself wondering last week why veteran and veterinarian, two words with such different meanings, should have a similar root in the Latin vetus, or old. Again, an oddity suggesting a genealogical approach for its solution. Veteran presented no problem, for its root and its modern meaning coincide, no indication of history. Veterinarian turned out to be interesting. City dwellers tend to view vets as servants of their pampered dogs and cats. I forgot that the original veterinarians treated farm and herd animals, as do most modern vets, I guess. Pardon my New Yorker's parochialism. The link to vetus is through beast of burden, old in the sense of able to take a load. Cattle in Latin are veterinae. This general principle of historical science should apply to the Earth as well. The theory of plate tectonics has led us to reconstruct the history of our planet's surface. During the past 200 million years, our modern continents have fragmented and dispersed from a single supercontinent, Pangaea, that coalesced from earlier continents more than 225 million years ago. If modern oddities are the signs of history, we should ask whether any peculiar things that animals do today might be rendered more sensible as adaptations to previous continental positions. Among the greatest puzzles and wonders of natural history are the long and circuitous routes of migration followed by many animals. Some lengthy movements make sense as direct paths to favorable climates from season to season. They are no more peculiar than the annual winter migration to Florida of large mammals inside metallic birds. But other animals migrate thousands of miles from feeding to breeding grounds with astounding precision when other appropriate spots seem close at hand. Could any of these peculiar routes be rendered shorter and more sensible on a map of ancient continental positions? Archie Carr, world's expert on the migration of green turtles, has made such a proposal. A population of the green turtle, Chelonia midas, nests and breeds on the small and isolated central Atlantic island of Ascension. London soup chefs and victualling ships of Her Majesty's Navy found and exploited these turtles long ago. But they did not suspect, as Carr discovered by tagging animals at Ascension and recovering them later at their feeding grounds, that Chelonia travels 2,000 miles from the coast of Brazil to breed on this pinpoint of land hundreds of miles from other shores, this barely exposed spire in mid-ocean. Turtles feed and breed on separate grounds for good reasons. They feed on seagrasses and protected shallow water pastures, but breed on exposed shores where sandy beaches develop, preferably on islands where predators are rare. But why travel 2,000 miles to the middle of an ocean when other apparently appropriate breeding grounds are so much nearer? Another large population of the same species breeds on the Caribbean coast of Costa Rica. As Carr writes, the difficulties facing such a voyage would seem insurmountable if it were not so clear that the turtles are somehow surmounting them. Perhaps Carr reasoned, this odyssey is a peculiar extension of something much more sensible. A journey to an island in the middle of the Atlantic, when the Atlantic was little more than a puddle between two continents recently separated. South America and Africa parted company some 80 million years ago, when ancestors of the genus Chelonia were already present in the area. Ascension is an island associated with the mid-Atlantic ridge, a linear belt where new seafloor wells up from the Earth's interior. This upwelling material often piles itself high enough to form islands. Iceland is the largest modern island formed by the mid-Atlantic ridge. Ascension is a smaller version of the same process. After islands form on one side of a ridge, they are pushed away by new material welling up and spreading out. Thus, islands tend to be older as we move farther and farther from a ridge. But they also tend to get smaller and finally to erode away into underwater seamounts, for their supply of new material dries up once they drift away from an active ridge. Unless preserved and built up by a shield of coral or other organisms, islands will eventually be eroded below sea level by waves. They may also sink gradually from sight as they move downslope from an elevated ridge into the oceanic depths. Carr therefore proposed that the ancestors of Ascension green turtles swam a short distance from Brazil to a proto-Ascension on the late Cretaceous mid-Atlantic ridge. As this island moved out and sank, a new one formed at the ridge and the turtles ventured a bit farther. This process continued until, like the jogger who does a bit more each day and ends up a marathoner, turtles found themselves locked into a 2,000-mile journey. This historical hypothesis does not deal with the other fascinating question of how the turtles can find this dot in a sea of blue. The hatchlings float to Brazil on the equatorial current, but how do they get back? Carr supposes that they begin their journey by celestial cues and finally home in by remembering the character, taste, smell of ascension water when they detect the island's wake. Carr's hypothesis is an excellent example of using the peculiar to reconstruct history. I wish I could believe it. I'm not troubled by the empirical difficulties, for these do not render the theory implausible. Can we be confident, for example, that a new island always arose in time to replace an old one? For the absence of an island, for even one generation, would disrupt the system. And would the new islands always arise sufficiently on course to be found? Ascension itself is less than 7 million years old. I am more bothered by a theoretical difficulty. If the entire species, Chelonia mitis, migrated to Ascension, or even better, if a group of related species made the journey, I would have no objection, for behavior can be as ancient and as heritable as form. But C. mitis lives and breeds throughout the world. The Ascension turtles represent only one among many breeding populations. Although its ancient ancestors may have lived in the Atlantic puddle 200 million years ago, our record of the genus Chelonia does not extend back beyond 15 million years, while the species C. mitis is probably a good deal younger. The fossil record, for all its faults, indicates that few vertebrate species survive for as many as 10 million years. In Carr's scheme, the turtles that made the first trips to proto-ascension were rather distant ancestors of C. mitis, in a different genus at least. Several events of speciation separate this Cretaceous ancestor from the modern green turtle. Now consider what must have happened if Carr is right. The ancestral species must have been divided into several breeding populations, only one of which went to proto-ascension. This species then evolved to another and another throughout however many evolutionary steps separated it from C. mitis. At each step, the ascension population kept its integrity, changing in lockstep with other separate populations from species to species. But evolution, so far as we know, doesn't work this way. New species arise in small, isolated populations and spread out later. Separate subpopulations of a widely dispersed species do not evolve in parallel from one species to the next. If the subpopulations are separate breeding stocks, what is the chance that all would evolve in the same way and still be able to interbreed when they had changed enough to be called a new species? I assume that C. mitis, like most species, arose in a small area sometime within the last 10 million years, when Africa and South America were not much closer together than they are today. In 1965, before continental drift became fashionable, Carr proposed a different explanation that makes more sense to me because it drives the ascension population after C. mitis evolved. He argued that ancestors of the ascension population accidentally drifted on the equatorial current from West Africa to Ascension. Carr points out that another turtle, the West African ridley, Lepidoculus olivacea, colonized the South American coast by this route. The hatchlings then drifted to Brazil in the same east-to-west current. Of course, getting back to ascension is the problem, but the mechanism of turtle migration is so mysterious that I see no barrier to supposing that turtles can be imprinted to remember the place of their birth without prior genetic information transmitted from previous generations. I don't think the validation of continental drift is the only factor that caused Carr to change his mind. He implies that he favors his new theory because it preserves some basic styles of explanation generally preferred by scientists, incorrectly in my iconoclastic opinion. By Carr's new theory, the peculiar ascension route evolved gradually in a sensible and predictable fashion, step by step. In his former view, it is a sudden event, an accidental, unpredictable vagary of history. Evolutionists tend to be more comfortable with non-random, gradualistic theories. I think that this is a deep prejudice of Western philosophical traditions, not a reflection of nature's ways. I regard Carr's new theory as a daring hypothesis in support of a conventional philosophy. I suspect that it is wrong, but I applaud his ingenuity, his effort, and his method, for he follows the great historical principle of using the peculiar as a sign of change. I'm afraid that the turtles illustrate another aspect of historical science, this time a frustration rather than a principle of explanation. Results rarely specify their causes unambiguously. If we have no direct evidence of fossils or human chronicles, if we are forced to infer a process only from its modern results, then we are usually stymied or reduced to speculation about probabilities. For many roads lead to almost any Rome. This round goes to the turtles, and why not? While Portuguese sailors hugged the coast of Africa, Colonia Midas swam straight for a dot in the ocean. While the world's best scientists struggled for centuries to invent the tools of navigation, Colonia looked at the skies and proceeded on course. 3. Double Trouble. Nature marks Isaac Walton as a rank amateur more often than I had imagined. In 1654, the world's most famous fisherman, before Ted Williams, wrote of his favorite lure. "I have an artificial minnow, so curiously wrought and so exactly dissembled that it would beguile any sharp-sighted trout in a swift stream." An essay in my previous book, Ever Since Darwin, told the tale of Lampsilus, a freshwater clam with a decoy fish mounted on its rear end. This remarkable lure has a streamlined body, side flaps simulating fins and tail, and an eye spot for added effect. The flaps even undulate with a rhythmic motion that imitates swimming. This fish, constructed from a brood pouch, the body, and the clam's outer skin, fin and tails, attracts the real item and permits a mother clam to shoot her larvae from the brood pouch toward an unsuspecting fish. Since the larvae of Lampsilus can only grow as parasites on a fish's gill, this decoy is a useful device indeed. I was astounded recently to learn that Lampsilus is not alone. Ichthyologist Ted Peach and David Grobecker recovered a single specimen of an amazing Philippine anglerfish, not as a reward for intrepid adventures in the wilds, but from that source of so much scientific novelty, the local aquarium retailer. Recognition, rather than machismo, is often the basis of exotic discovery. Anglerfish lure their dinner rather than a free ride for their larvae. They carry a highly modified dorsal fin spine affixed to the tips of their snouts. At the end of this spine, they mount an appropriate lure. Some deep-sea species, living in a dark world untouched by light from the surface, fish with their own source of illumination. They gather phosphorescent bacteria in their lures. Shallow water species tend to have colorful, bumpy bodies and look remarkably like rocks encrusted with sponge and algae. They rest inert on the bottom and wave or wiggle their conspicuous lures near their mouths. Baits differ among species, but most resemble, often imperfectly, a variety of invertebrates including worms and crustaceans. Peach and Grobecker's anglerfish, however, has evolved a fish lure every bit as impressive as the decoy mounted on Lampsilus's rear, a first for anglerfish. Their report bears as its appropriate title, The Complete Angler, and cites as an epigraph the passage from Walton previously quoted. This exquisite fake also sports eye-like spots of pigment in the right place. In addition, it bears compressed filaments representing pectoral and pelvic fins along the bottom of the body, extensions from the back resembling dorsal and anal fins, and even an expanded rear projection looking for all the world like a tail. Peach and Grobecker conclude, the bait is nearly an exact replica of a small fish that could easily belong to any of a number of percoid families common to the Philippine region. The angler even ripples its bait through the water, simulating the lateral undulations of a swimming fish. These nearly identical artifices of fish and clam might seem at first glance to seal the case for Darwinian evolution. If natural selection can do this twice, surely it can do anything. Yet, continuing the theme of the last two essays and bringing this trilogy to a close, perfection works as well for the creationist as the evolutionist. Did not the psalmist proclaim, "The heavens declare the glory of God, and the firmament showeth his handiwork"? The last two essays argued that imperfection carries the day for evolution. This one discusses the Darwinian response to perfection. The only thing more difficult to explain than perfection is repeated perfection by very different animals. A fish on a clam's rear end and another in front of an angler fish's nose, the first evolved from a brood pouch and outer skin, the second from a fin spine, more than doubles the trouble. I have no difficulty defending the origin of both fishes by evolution. A plausible series of intermediate stages can be identified for Lampsilus. The fact that anglerfish press a fin spine into service as a lure reflects the jury-rigged, parts-available principle that made the panda's thumb and the orchid's labellum speak so strongly for evolution. But Darwinians must do more than demonstrate evolution. They must defend the basic mechanism of random variation and natural selection as the primary cause of evolutionary change. Anti-Darwinian evolutionists have always favored the repeated development of very similar adaptations in different lineages as an argument against the central Darwinian notion that evolution is unplanned and undirected. If different organisms converge upon the same solutions again and again, does this not indicate that certain directions of change are preset, not established by natural selection working on random variation? Should we not look upon the repeated form itself as a cause of the numerous evolutionary events leading toward it? Throughout his last half-dozen books, for example, Arthur Koestler has been conducting a campaign against his own misunderstanding of Darwinism. He hopes to find some ordering force constraining evolution to certain directions and overriding the influence of natural selection. Repeated evolution of excellent design in separate lineages is his bulwark. Again and again, he cites the nearly identical skulls of wolves and the Tasmanian wolf. This marsupial carnivore looks like a wolf, but is by genealogy more closely related to wombats, kangaroos, and koalas. In Janus, his latest book, Koestler writes, "Even the evolution of a single species of wolf by random mutation plus selection presents, as we have seen, insurmountable difficulties. To duplicate this process independently on island and mainland would mean squaring a miracle." The Darwinian response involves both a denial and an explanation. First, the denial. It is emphatically not true that highly convergent forms are effectively identical. Louis Dolo, the great Belgian paleontologist who died in 1931, established a much misunderstood principle, the irreversibility of evolution, also known as Dolo's Law. Some ill-informed scientists think that Dolo advocated a mysterious directing force, driving evolution forward, never permitting a backward peak. And they rank him among the non-Darwinians who feel that natural selection cannot be the cause of nature's order. In fact, Dolo was a Darwinian interested in the subject of convergent evolution, the repeated development of similar adaptations in different lineages. Elementary probability theory, he argued, virtually guarantees that convergence can never yield anything close to perfect resemblance. Organisms cannot erase their past. Two lineages may develop remarkable superficial similarities as adaptations to a common mode of life, but organisms contain so many complex and independent parts that the chance of all evolving twice toward exactly the same result is effectively nil. Evolution is irreversible. Signs of ancestry are always preserved. Convergence, however impressive, is always superficial. Consider my candidate for the most astounding convergence of all, the ichthyosaur. This seagoing reptile with terrestrial ancestors converged so strongly on fishes that it actually evolved a dorsal fin and tail in just the right place and with just the right hydrological design. These structures are all the more remarkable because they evolved from nothing. The ancestral terrestrial reptile had no hump on its back or blade on its tail to serve as a precursor. Nonetheless, the ichthyosaur is no fish, either in general design or in intricate detail. In ichthyosaurs, for example, the vertebral column runs through the lower tail blade. In fish with tail vertebrae, the column runs into the upper blade, the ichthyosaur remains a reptile, from its lungs and surface breathing to its flippers made of modified leg bones, not fin rays. Kessler's carnivores tell the same tale. Both placental wolf and marsupial wolf are well designed to hunt, but no expert would ever mistake their skulls. The numerous small marks of marsupiality are not obliterated by convergence in outward form and function. Second, the explanation. Darwinism is not the theory of capricious change that Kessler imagines. Random variation may be the raw material of change, but natural selection builds good design by rejecting most variants while accepting and accumulating the few that improve adaptation to local environments. The basic reason for strong convergence, prosaic though it may seem, is simply that some ways of making a living impose exacting criteria of form and function upon any organism playing the role. Mammalian carnivores must run and stab. They do not need grinding molar teeth since they tear and swallow their food. Both placental and marsupial wolves are built for sustained running, have long, sharp-pointed canine teeth, and reduced molars. Terrestrial vertebrates propel themselves with their limbs and may use their tails for balance. Swimming fish balance with their fins and propel from the rear with their tails. Ichthyosaur, living like fish, evolved a broad, propulsive tail, as whales did later, although the horizontal flukes of a whale's tail beat up and down, while the vertical flukes of fish and ichthyosaurs beat from side to side. No one has treated this biological theme of repeated exquisite design more eloquently than D'Arcy Wentworth Thompson in his 1942 treatise on growth and form, still in print and still as relevant as ever. Sir Peter Medawar, a man who eschews hype and exaggeration, describes it as beyond comparison the finest work of literature in all the annals of science that have been recorded in the English tongue. Thompson, zoologist, mathematician, classical scholar, and prose stylist, won accolades as an old man, but spent his entire professional life in a small Scottish university because his views were too unorthodox to win prestigious London and Oxbridge jobs. Thompson was more a brilliant reactionary than a visionary. He took Pythagoras seriously and worked as a Greek geometrician. He took special delight in finding the abstract forms of an idealized world embodied again and again in the products of nature. Why do repeated hexagons appear in the cells of a honeycomb and in the interlocking plates of some turtle shells? Why do the spirals in a pine cone and a sunflower, and often of leaves on a stem, follow the Fibonacci series? A system of spirals radiating from a common point can be viewed as either a set of left or right-handed spirals. Left and right spirals are not equal in number, but represent two consecutive figures of the Fibonacci series. The Fibonacci series is constructed by adding the previous two numbers to form the next: 1, 1, 2, 3, 5, 8, 13, 21, etc. The pine cone may, for example, have 13 left spirals and 21 right spirals. Why do so many snail shells, ram's horns, and even the path of a moth to light follow a curve called the logarithmic spiral? Thompson's answer was the same in each case. These abstract forms are optimal solutions for common problems. They are evolved repeatedly in disparate groups because they are the best, often the only, path to adaptation. Triangles, parallelograms, and hexagons are the only plane figures that fill space completely without leaving holes. Hexagons are often favored because they approximate a circle and maximize area within relative to the supporting walls. Minimum construction for the greatest storage of honey, for example. The Fibonacci pattern emerges automatically in any system of radiating spirals built by adding new elements at the apex, one at a time in the largest space available. The logarithmic spiral is the only curve that does not change its shape as it grows in size. I can identify the abstract Thompsonian forms as optimal adaptations, but to the larger metaphysical issue of why good form often exhibits such simple numerical regularity, I plead only ignorance and wonder. So far, I have only spoken to half the issue embodied in the problem of repeated perfection. I've discoursed on the why. I've argued that convergence never renders two complex organisms completely identical, a circumstance that would strain Darwinian processes beyond their reasonable power, and I have tried to explain close repeats as optimal adaptations to common problems with few solutions. But what about the how? We may know what the fish of Lampsilis and the lure of the anglerfish are for, but how did they arise? This problem becomes particularly acute when the final adaptation is complex and peculiar, but built from familiar parts of different ancestral function. If the angler's fish-like lure required 500 entirely separate modifications to attain its exquisite mimicry, then how did the process begin? And why did it continue, unless some non-Darwinian force, cognizant of the final goal, drove it on? Of what possible benefit is step one alone? Is a 500th of a fake enough to inspire the curiosity of any real item? D'Arcy Thompson's answer to this problem was overextended but characteristically prophetic. He argued that organisms are shaped directly by physical forces acting upon them. Optima of form are nothing more than the natural states of plastic matter in the presence of appropriate physical forces. Organisms jump suddenly from one optimum to another when the regime of physical forces alters. We now know that physical forces are too weak in most cases to build form directly, and we look to natural selection instead. But
we are derailed. We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.